strummed the guitar light, the way he stroked my back, 'cause he's shy sometimes. I ask him to dance, but oh, he won't dance. No, he don't know he's a beautiful. Oh. He pulled back the veil and showed the color of his heart is blue, so blue, so blue. But yes, I know you're leaving soon. Oh, well, baby, no, don't come so close. You're leaving, leaving soon. Baby, no, don't come so close. You're leaving.
So the ferry building, the steel structure was built in 1898 and actually survived both earthquakes. What's amazing about it, I love the mix of the old and the new. It's very historical, it's beautiful, but inside it's all about modern food and modern cuisine. It's very international. It's a source of inspiration for me.
Welcome.
This actually was back in the 1890s was the place where they had the trains come through. For people coming into San Francisco from the East Coast, as well as commuter ferries to Marin and the East Bay, which still happens today, but it's now basically been turned into this great market.
Mm. Oh my gosh, good.
And it's still sort of a welcoming to San Francisco with the clock tower. It's just such a nice historical way to celebrate San Francisco. You can't miss it with the view and the food and good people. It's amazing.
Oh, your shoulders are clear.
So where are we now?
Right now we're at a beautiful spot called Alamo Square, and it's home to the famous Painted Ladies, which are the famous Victorian houses. On a beautiful day like this, it's actually just a great day to kind of sit and chill and have a picnic. Well, what's something that's interesting about this area is that it's built on bedrock. So it's one of the safest places to be during an earthquake, and probably one of the reasons why the Painted Ladies are still standing here.
On a day like this.
It's a city, but it also feels like a town. There's so many great little neighborhoods to hang out in, and I think the people are really nice and genuine, and there's a good local atmosphere to being here.
That would be the Golden Gate Bridge, the famous bridge that is continually being painted. It takes so long to paint it, they just never stop. It's a 365-day-a-year job. The Golden Gate National Park is one of the largest national parks in the world. It's 80,000 acres. And the town, again, just craves biking, hiking, any kind of outdoor activity they can get. The Chrissy Field Center is an environmental education center for San Francisco Public Schools. We even have a beach hut cafe over there, so all the dog walkers and windsurfers can get refreshed.
You reminded me of plane rides, baby, of a takeoffs and landings, and watching the earth from the sky. Well, a moment, a dark moment, a light.
Now, MoMA's made this building its home since 1995, but this new wing just opened a couple years ago, and I hear it's quite a treat, a nice peaceful escape from the craziness of the city.
We drift and we float and we fall.
Arts is almost more organic to the culture here. It's very natural. People express themselves musically through different types of art, and so great music scene. And I like the fact that it has so much more of a natural flair to it.
We drift and we float and we fall.
We are currently at the De Young Museum, which is right in the middle of Golden Gate Park. This is a really special landmark of the city. It was opened in 2005, and it was done by the same architect that did the bird's nest in Beijing. I'm from Ethiopia. I was born in Ethiopia, in Addis Ababa, and I left when I was a year and a half, and we went to Germany, and from Germany we came to the States. So tonight is the Friday night series at the De Young, and it's a whole really interesting thing about how museums actually all over the country are trying to find new ways of interfacing with audiences and really bringing audiences in a more meaningful way than just looking at a painting or a picture.
Yeah.
San Francisco is a super diverse place, and when you take the Bay Area more broadly, it's even more diverse. That's really important to me as an artist. That's where the juice is, you know, where all that creativity crosses. People really identify San Francisco with its artists, and particularly in the Mission, which is the music scene that I came out of. So next, we're gonna zip over to the Mission District to head to the Red Poppy Art House. It's really my creative home.
Hey, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
All right.
It's really meant to be a creative hub and a place where artists can meet each other, really artists of multiple disciplines and from multiple backgrounds. Well, it's Sunday morning. It's approximately 8 a.m. I can't do the right thing. We're in the marina at the water's edge, and we're headed to the Wave Organ. I think it's a brilliant intersection of nature and ingenuity. I grew up in Falls Church, Virginia, and I knew I had my eye on San Francisco, and I graduated college and I moved out here, and it's been about 5 years now. Shame for where to be the same. Should I read it out loud in my radio voice? The sounds you hear are created by the movement of waves in and out of a series of submerged pipes. The full range of music is best heard by holding your ear close to the listening ports. Ready? They're talking a lot of trash on Los Angeles. I don't know if you guys can hear that. What's pretty ingenious about the Wave Organ is that even if you don't hear anything, it's still incredibly beautiful. It thrives as an urban hub would, but it also has this incredible, these incredible elements of nature that are infused within it, and people aspire to come here, and there's such incredible history. And so to live here daily is not something that I take for granted.
Now, San Francisco is known for a lot of their coffee shops. This is a new spot, and it's become my favorite. It's a place called Sight Glass here on 7th Street between Folsom and Howard. This is Justin, one of the owners. Talk soft so you fall asleep. So I think what's cool about Sight Glass is that you can see the process of roasting. So you can see the green beans being roasted and then follow that process through the cup. For me, it's kind of like when you eat in an open kitchen, like a sushi bar. There's something really nice about seeing that whole process happen. So this is kind of the coffee version of that. I think San Francisco is a city that's always appreciated craftsmanship, especially when it has to do with raw materials being processed in some form and consumed. Certainly coffee is no different. San Francisco has a large Mexican population, and it's really congregated around the Mission area. So there's a lot of authentic Mexican restaurants because there's an audience for that. And I think it's important to visit a Mexican restaurant when you're in San Francisco. So we're here in the heart of the Mission. We're going to Taqueria Vallarta. We're going to go meet Luis, who's our butcher at Benu Restaurant. But he's also a first-generation Mexican-American from Guadalajara. And he's really familiar with all the taquerias in San Francisco. You got a lengua?
Yeah.
Can you order me a lengua and tripe?
Yeah.
So we're going to put our condiments on. We have fresh crunchy radishes, chopped raw onion, fresh cilantro, and salsa we'll put on the side. Want some salsa?
I have to put it everywhere.
I think Mexican food is a very honest cuisine. I think all the flavors speak for themselves. If you look at the tacos we're having, all the toppings are raw, unadulterated. They're not even seasoned. But when combined together, they make up for an extraordinary flavor combination, but it's a very honest style of cooking.
What's up? I'm gonna do coffee. To go. Yeah, to go. I am all in a ball in your front yard. Thanks, Rem. You got it. Have a good one. All right, let's go find a good view up in Tank Hill. We're gonna go over to Viz, down to the Castro, and then straight up the hill. So, see the sunset. This is kind of the lower height, upper height boundary right here. We'll crossroads. The trick is you do not get on that interstate bus. You can find your way around a lot of the hills in the city, but sometimes they're unavoidable. Like the one we're gonna go up is unavoidable on 17th Street. Here's the Castro. It's kind of a good view. This is pretty bad. I'd say this is like top three or top five bad in the city. Take these stairs right up here, up to the top. This is a tank hill. And this was, there was a water tank here they built in the 1890s. But in World War II, they put all these eucalyptus trees on this tank to shield it from the Japanese, from any potential Japanese bombing runs here. So, but yeah, the tank got taken out in the 70s, and now it's just this killer viewpoint that really only the locals know about. All right, there's the city.
He strummed the guitar light, the way he stroke my back.
Yeah, this is pretty much the $1 million view that is free. Right now, you can see all the way to the Berkeley Hills and, you know, Tiburon, the North Bay, the Marin Headlands over here, out to the Golden Gate. It's a view to die for right now. It's incredible. San Francisco is, it's a little bit of an amusement park, you know. It has its own sort of reality to it. The rules don't quite apply, but then they apply a little bit more. It's a little bit its own thing that doesn't quite translate to anywhere else. It's beautiful, it's gorgeous, you know, it's a unique spot for sure. No, baby, no, don't come so close, you're leaving. Even who wanna baby, no, don't come so close, you're leaving.